As you can see, the topic's name is straight lines. So this is the first session of straight lines. We will at least take 3 sessions to complete it. Okay, this is not a small chapter. It has got a lot of aspects into it, and all of them are very, very basic, essential features of your coordinate geometry. Because without them, I think it will be very difficult for you to survive and do well in coordinate geometry. Okay, so this chapter, you can say, is the platform, is the basis, or is the foundation of your further learning of coordinate geometry. Coordinate geometry is a very big vertical of mathematics. We are further going to talk about 5 more chapters: pair of straight lines, circles, parabola, ellipse, hyperbola. All of them would be under the coordinate geometry section. So what are we going to learn in straight lines? First thing I'm going to start with is the prerequisites. The prerequisites, which is actually your review of the Cartesian coordinate system. A review of the Cartesian coordinate system. Cartesian coordinate system. So mostly we'll be working with Cartesian coordinates only, the one which was given by the French mathematician René Descartes. So the French mathematician was René Descartes. Okay. We are not going to talk much about polar coordinates, which was given to us by Newton. But however, I'm sure all of you are aware of polar coordinates as well. Okay. So under this review, we are going to first talk about the distance formula. Okay. We all know distance formula. It's just a quick recap. As you can see, it's a review. Review means I'll be quickly revisiting. Distance formula. Okay, so if you have 2 points on the Cartesian coordinate, okay, we all know how a Cartesian coordinate is made. So we have 2 reference lines, which are called the x-axis and the y-axis respectively, which are at right angles to each other. The point where the axes meet is called the origin. So now when you refer to any point, let's say a point A, which has got coordinate as x1, y1, what does x1 represent? X1 represents, or you can say mod x1 represents, how far is your point from the y-axis. Or you can say x1 represents the directed distance. I've used the word directed distance, right? A distance which has got a direction, just like a vector quantity. So x1 represents the directed distance of the point from the y-axis, and y1 represents the directed distance of the point from the x-axis, right? So if you have 2 points, A and B, whose coordinates are as shown to you on the screen, what is the distance between them? What is the distance between them? How do you find it? Very simple. Let us say I construct a right angle triangle over here. Let me say this is point M. Okay. What would be the coordinates of M point? Remember, M will share the same Y coordinate as A and same X coordinate as B. So this will be X2, Y1. Correct. So if I ask you a simple question, what do you think is the distance of AM, or what is the length AM if I ask you? So what is the length AM over here? You'll say, okay, I know that A is at a distance of X1, directed distance X1 from the y-axis, and M is at a directed distance X2 from the y-axis. Correct. So if you know that there are 2 points whose distances from a fixed line is x1 and x2, then what is the distance between the points themselves? You will say simple, it is mod x2 minus x1, or mod x1 minus x2. Remember, mod basically is important because I'm talking about the distance over here. So mod x2 minus x1. Similarly, what would be the length BM? BM will say mod y2 minus y1. So BM is mod y2 minus y1. Now you can use your Pythagoras theorem over here. So Pythagoras theorem says AB square is equal to AM square plus BM square. Correct? So AM square means x2 minus x1 the whole square. The moment you are squaring it, mod becomes irrelevant to us. Y2 minus y1 square. So this is your AB, which is under root of this. This is the distance formula, which I am sure all of you know from class 9th onwards. Okay, any questions here? Any questions? Easy? Okay, so if this is easy, I have a question for all of you. Let us solve this question. Very simple question. Find the coordinates of the circumcenter of the triangle whose vertices are as given to you on the screen. Also find its radius. Very simple question, just based on this formula which we have done. So all of you, please solve this and put forth your response on the chat box. Yes, Rajaji Nagar people still haven't told me, when is the exam starting? Okay, 1st of October. Oh, sorry, I was actually not looking at my chat. I'm so sorry. Okay. 1st of October. Gandhi Jayanti is on 2nd October, right? So I'm sure everybody would have got the notification for the leaves that Centum Academy is giving you. Finally, so you don't have any classes from 18th to 25th of October, inclusive of both the days. So the last class that will happen will be on 17th, if at all you have any class on 17th. And the class after the reopening will happen on 26th. Okay, so 18th to 25th, no classes for you. Of course, we'll give you some assignments. We'll give you some homeworks. Okay. What, sir? Vacation also, you're not allowing us to stay properly. Okay. Good, Raghav. Excellent. What about the center coordinates? Nobody has given me the center coordinates so far. So let us say, this is your A, this is your B, this is your C. This is not to the exact positioning of them in the coordinate axes. I'm just randomly drawing it. Okay. But wherever required, I would suggest you to draw your diagrams as close to scale and as accurate as you can, because many a times that also gives you a lot of hint. Yeah. So this was a triangle. I hope you all know that the circumcenter is obtained by perpendicularly bisecting the sides. Okay, this is your circumcenter given by S. Very good, Titiksha. Kinshuk, I think so. That's not correct. Just check your working, Kinshuk. Okay, very simple. If you know that there's a point which is going to be the circumcenter, its distance from the vertices should all be the same, right? So SA should be same as SB, should be same as SC, isn't it? Yes or no? Okay, so SA will be equal to SB is equal to SC. Remember, this will result into two independent equations. Please do not think that there are three equations coming from here. Because if you do SA equal to SB and you do SA equal to SC, it will automatically imply SB equal to SC. Okay. So here you can get only two independent equations from each other. So let's say I do SA equal to SB. Now, for that, I need to assume this point let's assume it to be x comma y. But my advice is don't assume things to be x comma y in coordinate geometry, because when you're writing equations, you are also using x comma y. So that will create a confusion. Okay. Since there is no equations involved over here. I mean, of course, equations will come, but there is no point, or we don't have to state any kind of an equation in our answer. We can take it to be x comma y. But my advice to you is don't take x comma y as the name of any point. That's not advisable, right? Okay. So what is SA? SA would be under root of, now can I say SA is equal to SB will result into SA square is equal to SB square. Both are same thing. So SA square will be x minus 5 whole square, y plus 1 whole square. SB will be x plus 1 whole square, y minus 5 whole square. Okay. So if you simplify this, you'll get minus 10x. You'll get a plus 2y. You will get 25 plus 1. Here also you'll get 2x. You'll get minus 10y and 25 plus 1. So 25 plus 1 will go off. Remember, I'm not writing x square and y square because I know they will get cancelled off. So I always take a minimalistic approach. I write as less as possible, because the more you write, more mistakes you'll do. Okay. So this will give you 12x is equal to 12y. That means x is equal to y. So this is my first condition. That means the x and the y coordinates, which is called abscissa and ordinate. I hope you know x coordinate is called the abscissa. Y coordinate is called the ordinate. The abscissa and ordinate would be equal. Second thing I can use is, let's say SA is equal to SC. That means SA square is equal to SC square. So again, if I write that expression, I'll have x minus 5 whole square, y plus 1 the whole square is equal to SC square. SC square is x minus 6 the whole square, y minus 6 the whole square. Okay. So this will give you minus 10x plus 2y plus 26. This will give you minus 12x minus 12y plus 36 plus 36, which is 72. Okay. Let me see if I can drag up. Oh, I have reached the end of the screen. Okay, anyways, I'll try to squeeze in over here. So this will give you 2x plus 14y is equal to 46. Remember, x and y are equal. So 16x is equal to 46. So x is equal to 23 by 8. Okay, so y will also be equal to 23 by 8 because x and y are equal. Okay, so this was your second equation. I'm solving 1 and 2 simultaneously. So your center coordinates would be 23 by 8 comma 23 by 8. Correct. So what is going to be the radius? Radius basically is the distance of this point from any one of the coordinates. Okay, so let's say I want to find out the radius. Radius would be under root of 23 by 8 minus 6 the whole square. And the same thing repeated once again. So that's actually a good thing for us, because we can write it as 23 by 8 minus 6 times root 2. That's going to give you mod of it. That's going to give you 25 by 8, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, 25 by 8 root 2 units. Easy question, everybody would have got it. Later on, when we learn more things, we'll solve it by different methods. We'll find equations of the sides, we'll find out the equations of their perpendicular bisectors, and then we'll see where they meet and get our answer. But as of now, since we have only learned distance formula officially in today's class, I'm going to use this. Okay. Can you go down once again? Yes, sure. Is this fine, Shraddha? Oh, sorry, Siddhant. Left. Yeah. Thank you so much. Let's go on to the next question. Next question. Let's take next question. If the line segment joining the points A, B and C, D subtend an angle of theta at the origin, find cos of theta. Find cos of theta. So basically the question is pretty simple. If you have a point A, B, if you have a point B, C, D, okay? And if you connect it to origin, I'm not solving it, by the way, I'm just making a diagram for myself because later on I have to make it. What is this angle theta that they're asking? What is this angle theta that they're asking? I'll put the poll on. Oh my God, three answers and all of them have chosen different options. Okay. No using of slope concept. So those who have done already straight lines in your school, our slope concept is not required. Just by the use of distance formula, we need to solve it. Okay, Akshat, good. We'll check. Let me take your attendance also. Okay, let's finish this off in the next 30 seconds. Of you have responded so far. Next 30 seconds, we'll close the poll. Five, four, three, two, one. Please vote. Okay. Good enough data points. So 30 of you have voted and maximum vote has gone to both option B and C. Okay. So what I'm going to use here, I'm going to first connect B and A. Now we all know the cosine law. Cosine law, cos of theta is given by the side OA square, OB square, minus AB square by 2 times OAOB. Correct? So OA square is A square plus B square, OB square is C square plus D square, minus AB square. AB square will be A minus C the whole square, B minus D the whole square. correct? By 2 OA, OA is under root of A square plus B square, under root of C square plus D square. Okay. When you open the brackets, you would realize A square will get cancelled, B square will get cancelled, C square will get cancelled, D square will get cancelled. So what will be left of? You'll be left with 2AC, you'll be left with 2BD. And down there we have a 2, which will get cancelled off with that 2 on the numerator. So if you cancel it off, you get AC plus BD upon A square plus B square under root of C square plus D square. So which option is correct? Which option is correct? AC plus BD. Oh, option B. B is the right option. Okay. So, Janta was correct, but more than the correct Janta, wrong Janta was also there. Okay. Anyways, so let's now talk about the section formula. Do you want to copy something? Could you scroll down? Okay. Section formula. I'm sure you would have heard of it, right? Section formula, you have done it in class 10th, right? So in section formula, we basically learn the coordinates of points which divide the join of two points, either internally or externally. I think more you would have done internally than externally division, right? Okay, so we'll talk about two types of division. One is called internal division and the other is called an external division. Other is called the external division. Okay. So what is the internal division? So internal division is basically a case where join of two points, let's say A and B are two points. The join of these two points are divided by or is divided by a point C in such a way that C lies in the line segment connecting A and B. C lies within the line segment connecting A and B. So this is what we say. C is internally dividing the join of A and B. Okay. So normally when this ratio is M is to N, you have all learned this in your class 10th, I believe. That if the coordinates of A is x1, y1 and B is x2, y2, coordinate of C would be mx2 nx1 by m plus n, comma my2 ny1 by m plus n. Correct? Normally, we do not need the exact value of m and n, but we need its ratio. Correct? For example, if it is 2 is to 4 or 3 is to 6, or 5 is to 10, or 10 is to 20, it is all considered as 1 is to 2 only, right? So we normally need a simplest ratio of M and N, which we normally call as a K. Okay. Now, I would like you to understand one small thing over here. Very important. Very, very important. So first of all, the formula is changed like this. This is something which you all know. It's not a new thing to you. Okay. Now, I want you to understand this here is that when you talk about an internal division, this ratio K is actually taken as positive. So for internal division, we take K as positive. Why we take as positive is because K is what? K is the ratio of AC is to CB, right? That is what you're calling as M is to N, isn't it? But if you see, it is not the distance AC, it is the directed distance AC. So if I'm going from A to C, I will take this direction, isn't it? This is going to be my direction, correct? And if I'm going from C to B, this is going to be my direction. So since both the directions are in the same, facing towards the same way, or both are in the same direction, we take this ratio to be a positive quantity. Now, why I'm telling you this is because soon we learn about external division, there we'll take K as negative. So I'll come to it. So this is done because AC and CB are directed lens. Directed lens in the same direction. In the same direction. Okay, very, very important. Okay, so for internal division, when you're solving a problem, let's say I gave you a question and I said, in what ratio a point X divides the join of AB? Okay, so normally what you do, you assume the ratio to be K and proceed. Let's say K comes out to be positive. So the positiveness of this quantity will indicate that it was a case of internal division. It was a case of internal division. Okay. On the other hand, when you talk about external division is basically where the join of A and B, let's say this is my A and B, if extended, let's say I extend this further. Now it can be extending in both the directions, right? You can extend in the direction of A also, you can extend in the direction of B also. If extended, there is a point C lying here which will divide it in the ratio of M is to N. Are you getting my point? Right? But here, this M by N will actually be taken as a negative quantity. This will be taken as a negative quantity. Why? Because here, your K is actually AC. As you can see, AC are going this way. Correct? A to C. Is to CB. CB is coming downwards. See, they're opposite direction, just like vectors. Correct? So AC is to CB would be considered to be negative in nature because AC and CB are oppositely directed. Because AC and CB are oppositely directed. Guys, let me bring a very simple thing into your notice. You are now dealing with analytical geometry. You are now dealing with coordinate geometry where direction is also important. We are not dealing with geometry. Like in your childhood, you were dealing with geometry where only the magnitude mattered. How you know, big is a side or what is it, you know, length or what is the area. But now you're dealing with coordinate geometry. So science will come into picture which will signify directions to you. Are you getting my point? So here this ratio AC is to CB would be like two directed lens which are in opposite direction. And therefore the ratio AC by CB will become a negative value. Are you getting my point? So let's say you are solving a question and you get the K value as negative. Then it will indicate that it's a case of external division. It's a case of external division. Mind you, whether you're talking about internal or whether you're talking about external, A, B, C must be collinear for a case of division to happen. This is very important. Why it is important? I'll give you a question on that in some time. So let me complete this. So yes, so what would be the coordinates of C? The C coordinates, you can write it as K, X2. Let's say I can say this ratio to be K x2 plus x1 by k plus 1, comma k y2 plus y1 by k plus 1. Now normally this k itself is a negative quantity. So I'm not putting an extra negative sign in front of it. Else what will happen? You will take k as negative also and you will put a negative sign also. Gone. Wrong. Problem will become wrong. Okay. So formula is not going to change. It's just that k is a negative quantity and k cannot be minus 1. And k cannot be minus 1. So no change in the formula. It's just that k was positive here. Okay. And k is negative over here. But it cannot be minus 1. Are you getting my point here? Any questions? Any concerns over here? Any questions and concerns over here? Okay. Now a couple of things here. Many people ask me, sir, if k becomes negative, how would I know it is towards the side of B or it is C is towards the side of A? So how would you know? How would you know whether this C is towards B side or C is towards A side? Can somebody tell me that? Okay, if I give you a k, let's say I say k is minus 2 by 3. Was c towards the side of b or was it towards the side of a? Absolutely, Aniruddha. It was towards the side of a. So this is something very important. So please make a note of this. If your mod of k is greater than 1, then it is farther away from a. Okay. Then c is farther away from a. Farther away from a. If mod of k is between 0 to 1, then c is farther away from b. Farther away from b. Okay. Very important. Now, I would like you to do a small question based on this. I just wanted to test your basic understanding. Can I give you a question, small question? Anything that you would like to copy here? Oh, Archit is there. How are you, Archit? Feeling better? All well? Don't stress yourself, please. Your exams are coming near. Okay? So if you want, you can take a rest. Our classes are always recorded. I know you would always love to attend a live session because then you get to ask questions, participate in the class process. Okay, but if your health is not permitting, do take rest. No worries. Okay, so I have a question for you. Let's say A is 2, 3. B is 5, 0. And let's say C is 1, 1. Okay, so there are 3 points whose coordinate is given to you. Find the ratio in which C divides the join of AB. C divides the join of AB. Okay, simple question. I'm sure you would have done much more difficult question than this in your class 10th itself. But I would like to see your response. Find the ratio in which C divides the join of AB. Okay, very good. Rohan, that is the point actually. That's actually the point. Okay, so far, nobody has given me the right answer actually. Okay, trust me, actually, very good that all of you have responded. Right, Raghav, that's the answer. Actually, it was, okay, let's discuss. I'll not disclose that the fact right now. So let's say this is your A, 2, 3. Guys, is it lagging when you're seeing it? Is there a lag? Okay. It's fine, right? Okay. So let us say C point, which is 1, 1, is dividing it in the ratio of k is to 1. Okay. Normally, we assume k is to 1 because if k is positive, it will be a case of internal division. If k is negative, then it's a case of external division. So as of now, I just assume it to be k is to 1. Okay. So as per the formula, the answer would be 5k plus 2 by k plus 1, comma 5 into 0, k into 0, 1 into 3 by k plus 1. This should be the coordinate of the point C. Okay. And it is already given that it is 1, 1. Right? Now, the reason I gave this question was many people, they only check with one of the coordinates. For example, they will compare the abscissa. Okay. And then they will jump to a conclusion. Let's say I compare this and I jump to a conclusion that it is minus 1 by 4. That means it's the case of external division of ratio 1 is to 4. It being closer to A than B. Okay, but hold on. When you compare the ordinate, that is 3 by k plus 1 is equal to 1, you get the shock of your life when you see k value coming out to be 2. That means the ratio is also 2 is to 1 internally. When there is an inconsistency in your answer, it actually is a way that the question wants to tell you or the answer wants to tell you that there is no division happening at all. Okay. In fact, ABC will make a triangle. Remember, for division to happen, whether it is internal or external, ABC must be collinear. Okay. So since ABC are not collinear, meaning in the same line, collinear. It implies that C does not divide the join of A and B. So it was a bluff question. It was a trick question. So there's no two answer. The answer is there's no division happening at all. Why I gave this question is because 99%, as you can see, most of you made this mistake. You will just compare one. Don't have to compare one. You have to compare both of them. If both answers are coming out to be same, then that is the answer. So you can state that as your ratio. But if both of them are giving you different values for k, it is just a way that the answer tries to tell you that, hey, there is no division happening at all. Don't even try it. Okay. So just plot. Of course, plotting is another way or more robust way to do it. Is this fine? Any questions here? Any concerns? Okay. Let's take a small question on this. It's a match the column question. Let me put the poll on. Very good. Guys, again, when column type question comes, take a minimalistic approach. Okay, take a minimalistic approach means go for the factor which is bringing out the difference between the options. Okay, for example, I would never go for the first one. I will never solve the first question because if let's say I get an S, then there are three such options which say SSS. Okay, so I have to definitely go for the next one. Okay, so it's better to start with that particular, you know, column one question, which will bring about the distinction in the option pretty quickly. This is called minimalistic approach. None? Okay, let's wrap this up in another 20 seconds. Not many people have responded. Very good, Sinchan. Let's check. Okay, Akshat. Sinchan has responded after a long time, Sinchan. What happened, Sinchan? Busy? Kind of, okay. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, vote. Okay, Akshat has given a different answer. Okay. Chalo, we'll close the poll. I think, come on, if somebody's voting, please do so. Come on. Okay, let's adhere to our timelines, dear students. Nothing is more powerful than time. Yeah. So most of you have gone with C. C for cat. Let's check. So as I told you, since there is P, P, P coming here, R, R coming over here, I will either go and solve the fourth one or I will go and solve the second one. Okay. That will make my life a little easy. Okay. Let me solve for the second one. The ratio in which negative 2 comma negative 9 divides the line segment joining 1 comma 3 and 2 comma 7. Okay, so let's say this point is called the point C, which is negative 2 comma negative 9. Let the ratio be k is to 1. So 2k plus 1 by k plus 1 is equal to negative 2. And 7k plus 3 by k plus 1 is negative 9. Right. So let's see what comes out from here. So 2k plus 1 is minus 2k minus 2. Correct. So 4k is minus 3. So k is negative 3 by 4. Here also 7k plus 3 is minus 9k minus 9. 16k is minus 12. So k is minus 3 by 4. Okay. So this ratio p is to k is, now they have not mentioned whether they are, okay. So this can either be 7 or it could either be 1, but 1 is not there, right? Because if I take their absolute value, it should be actually be 1, right? Sorry, if I take their actual value, it should actually be 1. But they think it is 7. So the one which has got s, so S is only in the second one. Okay. So option number A becomes correct for me. Am I right? Because for 2, only option number A says S. Okay. Okay, fine. Let's say I have an element of doubt. I'll go for the next one. I'll go for, let's say, the fourth one. In what ratio? Oh, sorry, P comma Q divide the join of minus 1 comma 2 and 4 comma minus 5 in the ratio of 2 is to 3. Okay, so 2 into 4, 3 into minus 1 by 5 should be equal to your P. So P comes out to be 1. Okay, and let's see what's Q value. So 3 into 2, 2 into minus 5 by again 5, that gives me Q value as how much does it come out to be? 3 into 2, 2 into minus 5, 6 minus 4 by minus 5, minus 4 by 5. So P plus Q will become 1 by 5. P plus Q will become 1 by 5. Which option says 1 by 5? P says 1 by 5. So the one where your fourth one is mapped to P. So second one is mapped to S, and no, second one, D is also not mapping. Oh, external division. My bad. So sorry. Okay, it was a case of an external division. So I have to take one of them as a negative sign. Sorry. So this will become a 1 now. Okay, this will also become a 1 now, and this will become a negative sign. Okay, everything will change. My bad. So, yeah. So P value will become minus 3 minus 8, which is minus 11. And this will become minus 16. Correct? Yeah. But I think then none of the options will match. PQ divides externally the join of minus 1 and 2 and minus 4 and minus 5 in the ratio of 2:3. Okay. So what I did was I took one of them as negative. Yeah. Something strange is happening. So minus 2 into 4. Okay. 3 into minus 1 by minus 2 plus 3, which is going to be 1. That's correct. So that gives me minus 11 as the value of this. And this gives me minus 16. Minus 16. Okay. And they're asking me P plus Q. Oh, yeah. So this is minus 10. Correct. So this will give you 10, 16, correct. Now the sum is going to be 5. Which of them says five? R says 5, correct. So fourth one, whichever has an R, that will be the answer. So obviously option number one again has an R. So A is correct. Right? And only one person got this correct. Oh my God. Most of you went for C. Only one person got this correct. Okay, anyways, is this understood? So basically what I did was I had to take minus 2:3. So minus 2 will come over here. Okay, so minus 2 and plus 3 is coming over here. And minus 2 plus 3 will become 1 in the denominator, giving you P value as minus 11, Q value as 5. So Q value as 16. So P plus Q will become a 5, which is matching with R. Sir, can you check what you have done in second one? Okay, see, second one, what I have done. In the second one, I have just assumed the ratio to be anything. So I get minus 3:4. Okay. So they basically meant, because there could be two answers from it. It could be either be 1, correct? So now, see, you have taken it to be 3:-4. Okay, in that case, your answer will be minus 4 plus 3, which is minus 1. Okay, then yes. Option C will be correct. Okay, Janta was correct. Okay, correct, Raghav, correct. So I'll just... cross this and I'll tick mark this. Okay, thank you. So I was wondering how can so many people make a mistake? Yeah, sure, Shraddha. I'll scroll it to the right. So here my P plus Q value was actually coming out to be minus one, which is your Q option. So second is mapping with Q. Second is mapping with Q. And fourth one was mapping with R. So whichever said second one was Q and fourth one was R, that was only C option which said that. Done, copy it, Shraddha. No, Dev, actually, even I thought so. But the question was actually asking you to algebraically add P and Q along with their sign. Okay, so it could either be minus 3 plus 4 or it could be minus 4 plus 3. So minus 3 plus 4 will give you a 1, which is not there in your column number 2. So only possibility, as Raghav rightly pointed out, and I thank him for that, it will be minus 4 plus 3, which is going to give you a minus 1. How? See, 3 by minus 4 or minus 3 by 4, does it make a difference? Does it make a difference? Shraddha, both are fine, no? Both are same things. Correct. So if I say the ratio is minus 1 is to 2 or 1 is to minus 2, both are same thing. Any one of the M and N can be negative, right? Because ratio has to be negative. Okay. Yeah, it was slightly confusing question, but I think most of you were correct. Okay, guys. Now I'm going to a very serious type of a question. Okay. We have all learned our critical points in a triangle in our properties of triangles chapter. Okay. So let me name this concept as important points in a triangle. Okay. So we are going to first talk about centroid. What's a centroid? Centroid is the meeting point of the medians. Okay, so let's say I have medians. What is median? Median is basically a line which connects a vertex to the midpoint of the opposite side, isn't it? So let's say A, B, C, then it will connect to the midpoint of the opposite side. This is a median. Okay, so similarly, M, you can call it as P. They are all the midpoints of their respective sides. The meeting point of the median is called the centroid. Okay. We know that centroid divides the median in the ratio 2 is to 1, 2 towards the vertex side. 2 is to 1, 2 towards the vertex side. Similarly, the centroid G will divide CP in the ratio 2 is to 1, 2 towards the vertex side. This is also 2 is to 1. Okay. If you know the ratio, can we get the coordinates of G? Now, I'm sure you would have done this in your junior classes. So without much waste of time, I will only do it. So let us say this point is x1, y1. A coordinate is x1, y1. B coordinate is x2, y2. C coordinate is x3, y3. Okay. The midpoint is going to be x2 plus x3 by 2, comma y2 plus y3 by 2. Correct. Now, since you know M coordinate, right, and you know A coordinate, and you know this ratio is 2 is to 1. So what will be the G coordinate? G coordinate, you will say, it is simply 2 into x2 plus x3 by 2 plus 1 into x1 by 2 plus 1, comma, same thing for the y, 2 times y2 plus y3 by 2 plus 1 into y1 by 2 plus 1. Okay, if you simplify this, this will give you x1 plus x2 plus x3 by 3, comma y1 plus y2 plus y3 by 3. I'm sure you would have done this derivation in class 10. Okay, so everybody knows centroid is the point through which the center of mass of the triangular lamina will pass. Okay, if you generalize this, you take any polygon, and if you just do this summation of all the x coordinate by n, summation of all y coordinate by n, that will always give you the center of mass of that, you know, polygon lamina. Okay, so this is a point through which the center of mass of the triangular lamina will pass. This is known to everybody. Okay, now my question is, Can you give me the coordinates of, or can you prove that the coordinates of the in center of a triangle? Let me make a triangle first of all. Okay. Let me extend this further. Okay, how is an in-center formed? In-center is formed by internally bisecting these angles. So let's say this angle is bisected, this angle is bisected, and this angle is bisected. Okay, they will meet at the in-center, which we call as I. Okay, I would now like you to work on how do you get the coordinates of the in-center, given that the vertices coordinates are known to you. Remember, we had discussed this result in our properties of triangle, but we never got a chance to prove it. And I also told you that I will prove it in the coordinate geometry chapter. Correct? So day has come that we now prove this formula. So prove that the in-center coordinate is given by this expression, where A is the length of BC, small b is the length of AC, and small c is the length of AB. Would you like to try it out? Anybody? Okay, I'll also help you with it. First, get the coordinates or get the ratio in which D divides the join of BC, which I think you already know. Angle bisector theorem. Correct? I hope you all know this theorem, angle bisector theorem. Angle bisector theorem. Who will tell me what is angle bisector theorem? Class 10th concept. And I'm sure in autonomous you would have done it in a very, very detailed fashion. Yes, Shraddha, would you like to try what's an angle bisector theorem? Anybody? Very good. Very good, Ananya. So angle bisector theorem says that if there is an internal angle bisector in a triangle, then it will cut the opposite side in such a way that BD is to DC will be AB is to AC. Absolutely, Shraddha. Very, very good. This is something which is going to guide me to solve this question. Correct. So can I say this ratio BD is to DC here would be C is to B, correct? So this ratio is C is to B, correct? So if I know what is the coordinates of B and what is the coordinates of C, and I also know this ratio, can I not get the coordinates of D? Okay, so please tell me the coordinates of D. You'll say very simple, sir. It will be C into X3, B into X2. So let me write it down. B into X2, C into X3 by B plus C. Comma B into Y2, C into Y3 by B plus C. Any doubt here, any concerns here, please do let me know. Please do let me know. Okay. No problem with this. Coordinates of D, absolutely no problem. Okay. Now, all of you, please listen to this very carefully. If you look at the triangle, If you look at the triangle ABD, correct? Can I say I divides, or can I say like this? Can I say in triangle ABD, AI is to ID, Now look at the figure. AI is to ID will be equal to BA is to BD. By the same angle bisector theorem. By the same, what happened to my writing today? By the same angle bisector theorem. Correct? I'm sure you would agree with this. There is no discrepancy in this logic. Correct? Because if you see ABD, basically BI is like your internal angle bisector, isn't it? So if you think this to be a triangle, then AI is to ID would be same as BA is to BD. Am I right? Okay. Now, can somebody tell me what is BD length? Because AB length or BA length is C. What is BD length? Who will tell me what is BD length? AB is already C. My bad. What is BD length? What is BD length? Somebody please type on the screen. Please type in the chat box. Don't write anything on the screen, please. Yeah. What is BD length? Total length is A and this ratio is C to B. So what is BD length? That's my question. See, full length is A and this BD is to DC is C to B. Okay, let me draw it. So let's say there's a line whose length is A and there is a point which divides it in the ratio C is to B. Okay, my question is, what is BD length here? What is BD length? Correct. So it is going to be BD length will be equal to C by B plus C times A. Am I right? C by B plus C times A. Correct? No problem, Raghav. Understood, no? Arre, Baba, let's say this is 1:2 and this whole length is 5. Let us say. And I ask you, what is BD length? What will you say? You'll say 1/3 of 5. Isn't it? That's what you're going to say, no? So this is C by B plus C into the length A. Correct. So this makes it B plus C by A. Am I right? Everybody's happy till here because I don't want to proceed further if you're not happy till here. Clear, Ritu? Good. Everybody first write clear on your chat box. Then only I'm going to proceed. Don't keep any doubt. Why A? Prakul is asking why A? Because total length of BC was A, no? In a triangle, the side opposite to vertex A has a length small a. By convention, we follow this. Correct, Prakul? Okay. Now, my life is pretty easy after I get this is because I know this ratio is now B plus C is to A. This ratio is B plus C is to A. Okay, I'm writing it over here. Do you know A coordinate? Yes, X1, Y1. Do you know D coordinate? Yes, we just now figured out. Do you know the ratio in which I divides A and D? Yes, B plus C is to A. Then what are we waiting for? Let's find out I coordinate. Simple as that. So from here I can say coordinate of I would be, let me write it in some different color so that I distinguish it from the. So I coordinate would be B plus C times the X coordinate of D. So B plus C times X coordinate of D, which is this guy. BX2 CX3 by B plus C. Okay. Plus A times X1 by B plus C plus A. Similarly, I will do it for the Y coordinate. B plus C, BX2 CX3 by B plus C plus, oh, Why am I writing x? Sorry, y. Okay, a y1 by b plus c plus a. Okay, if you simplify this, you automatically would realize b plus c here and b plus c here will get cancelled off. Same with this guy also. And you will be left with ax1. Now I'm writing it as ax1, bx2, cx3 by a plus b plus c, comma, ay1, by2, cy3 by a plus b plus c. Is that okay? Understood? Any question? If possible, keep this in your mind. Okay. Now, I would like you to do this as a homework question. I will not do it right now for you. Let us say there is a triangle. I'll take a very thin triangle. I don't want to make a thick one. Okay. We all know that if you bisect this angle, let me use my tools. Let's say if you bisect this angle. Okay. Let's say this angle is same as this angle. Okay. So that angle is internally bisected. And let us say, let me extend this further. And let us say I externally bisect this angle. Okay, so what I have done, this angle is this angle. I have externally bisected it. Then they will meet at a point I1, which is basically called as one of the x centers. Okay, where I1 coordinate is given by minus ax1 bx2 cx3 by minus a plus b plus c, comma, comma, minus ay1 by2 plus cy3 by minus a plus b plus c. Okay, please prove this. Prove this for your homework. Okay, now I'm sure you would have got a trend here. If I had drawn the same thing opposite to B, that is called I2, you all know, correct? What would be I2 coordinate? Okay, I'll write it down over here. No need to prove all of them, just one is sufficient. I2 coordinate would be AX1 minus BX2, CX3 by A minus B plus C, comma AY1 minus BY2, CY3 by A minus B plus C, okay? And I3 would be AX1 BX2 minus CX3 by A plus B minus C and AY1 plus BY2 minus CY3 by A plus B minus C. Okay, just prove one of them. I think I1 is sufficient enough. This is just for your knowledge. So there is a trend here in the formula. If it is an in center, you'll all have plus 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 on the top. If you have an x center opposite to a, then only a will have a negative sign. Of course, both in the numerator, denominator, and also in the x and y coordinate both. Okay. If you're drawing x center opposite to b, there will be a minus sign in b. And if you're drawing an x center opposite to c, there will be a minus sign in c. So just prove one of them. You have not seen coordinate geometry. Let coordinate geometry start, Kinshuk. You will have to maintain a formula list. Okay. Can we move on to the next question? Actually, I would like to take that as a question rather than as a theory. Done, copied. Done. Okay. Next thing that we are going to talk about is your circumcenter. Is your circumcenter. Now I'm going to give this as a question to you. Let's take this as a question. Let us say you have a triangle. Okay. And okay, let's say this is a circumcenter. This is your x3, y3. So ABC is a triangle whose coordinates of the vertices are as given to you. S is the circumcenter. Prove that the circumcenter coordinates are given by x1 sine 2a, x2 sine 2b, x3 sine 2c by sine 2a plus sine 2b plus sine 2c. And similarly for your y coordinate or ordinate of the circumcenter, y1 sine 2a, y2 sine 2b, y3 sine 2c by sine 2a, sine 2b plus sine 2c. See, this formula is completely impractical because you will hardly see any kind of an uses for this formula. But let us take this as a question so that our understanding of section formula, or for that matter, our understanding of geometry is clear. Okay, so let's take this as a question. How will you solve this? What is 2a, 2b, 2c? A is basically this angle. This angle is A, this angle is B, this angle is C. How do you do this question? Anybody has any idea? Looks scary, right? The formula looks very scary. So how on earth I should get 2a, sine 2a, sine 2b and sine 2c? That's the first thing that we need to sort out. No, Ginshuk, don't worry about the formula per se. Think it as if it's a question. Okay. I'm not interested in knowing this formula. Neither do I endorse that you should know this formula. I am interested in solving it as a question. Let's say somebody has given me a question, prove that this is going to be a circumcenter coordinate. Okay, chalo, I'll help you out. I know most of you would be clueless as of now. What to do, from where to start, no idea. Okay, let me do one thing. Let me connect A to S and extend it further. Okay, let's say it meets somewhere over here. Okay, and let's say this point here is your point E. Let's say. Okay, at the same time, let me drop. Okay, first of all, what is the coordinate of E? How will I find it out? This is my first step towards solving this question. Now, in order to get the coordinate of E, I should know in what ratio E divides the join of B and C, right? So I need to know BE by EC. Okay, so what I'm going to do is just watch here. I'm going to drop a perpendicular from S onto BD, onto BC, and let me call this as a D. Okay. No. E is not the midpoint of BC, Prakul. E is not the midpoint of BC. I mean, E may not be the midpoint of BC. I'm not saying will not, may not. AE is not a median. Okay, now listen to this. I would make it very, very clear. Okay, let me make a triangle over here. Okay, and let me make a triangle over here also. Okay, can I say, all of you please listen to this. Can I say, B is to EC is nothing but area of triangle SBE by area of triangle SEC Would you agree? Would you agree that area of triangle SEB by area of triangle SEC will be B is to EC? Now, why is that so? It's very easy. The reason for saying so is that BSEB and SEC will have the same perpendicular, which is your SD length. Correct. So they will, the ratio of the area would be same as the ratio of their bases, which is actually BE is to EC. Yes or no? Correct? No similarity and all, Kinshuk. No similarity. See, look at this triangle. Look at this triangle, which I am showing with a white boundary. This triangle and the one I'm showing with a yellow boundary. Of course, SE would be overlapping in both the cases. These two triangles share the same perpendicular. Correct. Which is SD. SD is the same perpendicular. Correct. So can I say BE is to EC will be same as the ratio of the area of these two triangles? Okay. Now listen to this very carefully. Can I say SA, SB and SC all will be equal to your R, that is your circumcircle radius? Correct? Yes or no? Okay. Now I would like you to tell me one small thing, very, very small thing. What do you think is this angle? What do you think is the angle which I have shown to you on the figure? What is angle ESB? Anybody? ESB. Gayatri, tell me by what logic Gayatri it is 90 degree. By what logic it is 90 degree? Radius to center always forms 90 degree. I have not learned such a geometry. Why would radius to center will make a 90 degree? Okay. Anyways, let me make your life simpler. Guys, geometry is the father of all these coordinate geometry stuff. Okay, let me draw the same triangle, but now within a circle so that you are aware what you are doing. Let's say this is A, B, C. What is my question asking you? My question is asking you, let's say this is the center, okay? And I connect the center to A and extend it forward. And I make this, what is this angle I'm asking you? What is this angle I'm asking you? Now listen to this. If this is C, what is this angle? 2C, correct? So what is this angle? Pi minus 2C, my dear. None of you answered that. Come on, right? It's 2C, this at least you agree that this is 2C. Angle subtended at the center is double the angle subtended by the same arc on the opposite segment, correct? Yes or no? So this is 2C. So this remaining is pi minus 2C. Okay. Now what is the area of a triangle? Area of a triangle is nothing but half into product of the two adjacent sides, that is R and SE, into sine of the angle sandwiched between them. So sine of the angle is sine of pi minus 2C. Correct? By half SEC. Now, again, let me ask you this question. What do you think is this angle? White one. Let me write R, SE, sine of what should I write over it? Very good, Kinshuk. Pi minus 2B. Chalo, very good. So it's very obvious that this guy will be 2B. just like this guy was 2c. So this remaining one is pi minus 2b. Correct? Very good, Kinshuk. Nice one. So R gone, half gone, SE gone. So it is sine of 2c by sine of 2b. Correct? So what do I have? Oh my God, I figured out what ratio E divides BC. That is sine 2b is to sine 2c. Isn't it? So this ratio is sine 2c is to sine 2b. Correct? So I can get now my E coordinate. Now this question mark is solved. B is to EC. B is to EC is sine 2c is to sine 2b. So now I'm equipped enough to get my E coordinate. What is my E coordinate? Somebody please tell me fast. So my E coordinate would be sine 2b into x2. So I can write it like this, x2 sine 2b. Sine 2c into x3, that is x3 sine 2c by sine 2b. Oh, now I realize why it's 2a, 2b's angles are occurring. Oh, so this is, we are inching towards our solution. Okay, let me first finish off writing this. Are you all happy till this stage? Then only I will proceed further, else I will not proceed. You have to write happy. You have to write happy in your chat box. Not very happy. Why, Kinshuk, you answered, no? You should be very happy. Complicated, okay. So it's a complicated happiness. Okay, not everybody is happy. Yes, it is difficult, yeah. Come on, we are preparing for India's toughest exam. Okay, if it is easy, everybody will get it. Okay, now this is just half the proof done. Now we'll focus on what is AS is to SE, because then only I will get the ratio in which S divides the join of A and E. So what I'll do, I'll make a fresh triangle. Okay, everything is getting hodgepodge over here. So one fresh triangle, let me draw. Okay, so this is my new triangle. I will make some quick lines here. Okay, so this is your S. This was your E, which you figured out. Okay, don't worry about E right now. E is already safe with you. Now the problem is I need AS is to SE. What is AS is to SE? If I find this, my job is done. Pakka. We'll wrap this problem if I get my ES. How will I find S? So AS, you will say, sir, AS to I know. AS is R. No doubt about it, right? It is the circle radius only. How will I get SE? How will I get SE? Let me again draw this D back. How will I get SE length? Okay. Chalo, I'll help you out with this. Now, who will give me, what is this angle? Kinshuk, are you talking about the angle? Angle SD you are talking about? Length. D is 2B into 2C. How? And B is angle, my dear. How can length be in terms of angles? If I'm not right, B is an angle, right? Yes, sorry. If I'm not wrong, B is an angle. How can length be in terms of angles? Okay. Chalo, all of you, please pay attention over here. It's not a difficult thing. It's not a difficult thing. Can somebody tell me, it's a very simple question for all of you. Can somebody tell me, what is this angle? I want SD length somehow. This I know is R, and I want SD length. Can somebody tell me SD length? And for that, I need this angle. Can somebody tell me what is this angle? Or anyhow, I mean, it's not necessary that you give me by the same logic. Okay, one thing you would all agree that, okay, let's say I don't need that angle. Let me remove that. Do you all agree that this angle would be A? Do you all agree that this angle would be A? This is pakka. No problem with that. Okay. And you also told me a little while ago that this whole angle was pi minus 2c, correct? And this angle was A. So what is the remaining angle? So can I say this yellow guy is pi minus 2c minus A? Ah, big sigh of relief. Okay. That means this chotu guy, that is your angle DSE, will be pi minus 2c minus A, which is actually A plus B plus C minus 2c minus A. Why A plus B plus C? Because pi is the sum of the angles of a triangle. So I can write it as A plus B plus C. A gone, one of the C gone, so you'll get B minus C. So all of you are convinced that this small angle over here is actually B minus C. Okay. Now, listen to my logic. This length is R. So this length, SD, would be R cos A. Correct? SD is R cos A. Correct? So in this triangle, I'll redraw it again. In this triangle, you know that this length is R cos A. And you know this angle is B minus C. Can you not find out the length of SE from here? What is SE length? What is SE length? You'll say, sir, simple. It will be R cos A by cos B minus C. Yes or no? Yes or no? Agreed? Any questions here? Any questions? Please highlight. Now my problem is solved. No. AS was R. SE was R cos A by cos B minus C. R gone. So it will become cos B minus C by cos A. Okay. But the problem is, none in the answer or in the proof, I don't have B minus C kind of a term. Okay. So what should I do in that case? Okay. Don't worry, I have a solution for that. What should I explain once again, Kinshuk? SE length. SE. See, this same thing over here, I have just drawn for you over here. See this motion of my cursor. Okay. If this is R and this is A, SD is R cos A. You are convinced with SD? SD. This angle is B minus C. Just now we figured out B minus C. Correct. So this angle is known, base is known, hypotenuse is what you want to find out. No? You can find it out by your simple trigonometry. Okay. Now understood how SE length is found? Okay. Cool. Now all of you, please pay attention. This is very critical over here. I'm going to do some manipulations with this guy. So cos B minus C by cos A, I'm going to multiply with 2 sine A. Okay. Now, sine A is as good as sine B plus C. Isn't it? Because you're dealing with a triangle. Come on. Yes or no? A is pi minus b plus c. So sine A is sine b plus c. Go back to your trigonometry days. Okay. Now, transformation formula. What is 2 sine b plus c cos b minus c? Anybody will say it is sine 2b plus sine 2c, sir. Okay. And this is sine 2a. So what do I have? I have something very interesting for you. Basically, it tells you in what ratio does S divide the join of A and B. So it means that S divides the join of A and E in the ratio sine 2b plus sine 2c is 2 sine 2a. I think this is going to finish up my problem. Okay, so now let me go back to the figure again. So this guy S divides this in the ratio of sine 2b plus sine 2c is 2 sine 2a. Okay, and you already know x1, y1 is the coordinate for A, and E's coordinate is already known to you from here. This is your E coordinate. Okay, so I'll make the diagram once again for you so that we can finally wrap this up. Oh my God, three times we need to draw the diagram for this. Yeah, so see, this is the scenario currently for us. So let's say this was your S point. Okay, this ratio is sine 2b plus sine 2c is 2 sine 2a. This guy was x1, y1. And this guy was x2 sine 2b plus x3 sine 2c by sine 2b plus sine 2c, comma y2 sine 2b, y3 sine 2c by sine 2b plus sine 2c. Correct? So what should be the coordinate of S? This was my A. This was my E. So what should be the coordinate of S? Now I think we are all equipped enough to do that. So this multiplied with this guy. So I'm not writing the multiplication result. I'm not doing the multiplication. I'm just writing the final outcome from it. So this will be giving you this term. Okay. And sine 2a multiplied with x1. That is a simple looking term, that is x1 sine 2a, divided by the sum of these two ratios, which is actually sine 2a, sine 2b, sine 2c. Okay. Can you just do the same thing for y as well? Can you do the same thing for y as well? So y will be y2, comma y2, y2 sine 2b, y3 sine 2c plus y1 sine 2a by, and I think this is what we wanted to prove. Done. Okay. Big proof, right? But I'm sure after you have understood how to get the coordinate of E, and after you have understood AS is to SE, job is done. That you can carry out the remaining part of the question from your end also. Is this fine? My God, the whole screen is full. Okay, complicated, but I feel this is not beyond our understanding. It is definitely within our understanding. Okay. Can we go on to a next problem of a similar nature? Sir, if similar nature, then no need. Similar nature, yes. Or should I give it as a homework to you? What do you want? What do you want to do? Do it now, or you want to struggle at home? It's better you do it now only. Yeah, let's go. Let's do it, Dev. Bring it on, sir. Bring it on. We'll solve it. Okay, fourth point that we are going to talk about is orthocenter. What is orthocenter, my dear? Orthocenter is the point where the altitudes meet, isn't it? So if I draw the altitudes, altitudes, it is not a perpendicular bisector, let me tell you, it's an altitude. That means this is 90 degree. That is, the foot is 90 degree. Okay. So the meeting point of the altitude of a triangle is basically called its orthocenter. So let's say A, B, C. Okay. Orthocenter is represented by H. Okay. Now let us prove this as a question that the coordinates of the orthocenter is given by x1 tan A, x2 tan b x3 tan c upon tan a plus tan b plus tan c comma y1 tan a y2 tan b y3 tan c by tan a plus tan b plus tan c. Okay, so how do I do this question? Let me again do the needful. Let me again call this as D. So first get the coordinates of D. This is my request to you. Let's get the coordinate of D. How will you get the coordinate of D? Approach is same. See, similar approach. Homework that we won't solve. Yeah, and now your board semester exams will also begin, no? So sem term work will take a back seat. When is maths for RNR? Tenth is, yeah, a lot of time. Chalo, I'll also help you. Can somebody tell me BD is to DC? Sir, if you could tell this, we could get the answer for D, no? Okay, so it's okay, not to worry. I have a small, simple question for you. What is this angle? Okay, let's talk about this length. What is this length? BD. If you see, this length is C, this length is B, and this length is A. Okay. This angle over here, if I'm not mistaken, that is actually 90 degree minus B. Am I right? Right? Of course, this is 90 and this whole thing is B. So what is this left? 90 minus B. Correct. If this length is C, what is BD length then? You'll say BD length will now become C sine 90 minus B. That is C cos B. Yes or no? Correct? Any doubt, any concerns here, please highlight. What is DC length then? Same logic. So this angle will be 90 minus C. No doubt about that. And this length is B. So that is going to be B cos C. Thank you, Kinshuk. Clear? Okay. Now we all know from our sine rule that C is equal to 2R sine C and B is equal to 2R sine B. Can I write it like this? 2R, gone for a T. Sine C by cos C is tan C. And sine B by cos C is tan B. So can I say, my dear students, this is a big breakthrough for us. The ratio BD is to DC is tan C is to tan B. Wow, that's a big breakthrough for us. Correct. Right, because your answer also has similar kind of a term, no? Tan A, tan B, tan C. Correct. So it's a big achievement for us. Okay. So coordinate of D would be what? Coordinate of D would be tan B x2, or you can say x2 tan B, x3 tan C by tan B plus tan C, comma y2 tan B. I dislike writing y2 because same thing you have to copy again. But what to do? You have to write. Yeah. Okay. All right. Now, let us focus on what is AH is to HD. What is AH is to HD? Let me make a separate diagram for it. Meanwhile, note this down. This is a very important thing which we will use little later on. D coordinate, we will use little later on in our final answer. Okay, so note down D. Done? Note it down. Let me make a fresh diagram. Let me make a fresh diagram. Fresh. Ekdam fresh. Okay. So this is my altitude. Down, down, and down. Okay. A, B, C, H, D. Now, my problem statement is, what is AH is to HD? Okay. For that, let me find out AH. Ah, Ruchita, sign law. Ayo, ayo, Ramakrishna, sign law. Should I write it? Do you want me to write it? A by sine A is equal to B by sine B equal to C by sine C equal to 2R. No. Thank you. Okay. Chalo, my question is, what is AH? Who will tell me AH? Now, all of you listen to this very carefully. This is 90 degree. Correct. This length is C. Correct. This is angle A. Correct. Okay, let me call this for the time being as AF. So what is AF? What is AF? What is AF? AF, AF, AF. 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 Fast. What is AF? Somebody, come on. This is A. Sorry, this is C length. This angle is A. What is AF? This is 90 degree. AF. Tell me somebody, come on. C cos A. Yes or no? Yes or no? Have I said something wrong here? AF is C cos A. It's a right angle triangle. Hypotenuse is C. This angle is A. What is base? Base is C cos A. Class, you are there. Some of you would have fainted also now. Ayyo, sir, when will this get over? Okay, Ritu is the one who confirms it. Okay. Okay. What is AH? See, now this angle we all know is 90 minus C. Little while ago only we figured it out, right? 90 minus C. And your base, this is 90 degree. Base is C cos A. So what is your hypotenuse? What is your hypotenuse? What's your hypotenuse? Yeah, so you'll say C cos A. No, are hypotenuse will be smaller than the length. It is not possible, no, ever. So it will be C cos A divided by cos of 90 minus C, which is sine C. Is that fine? Agreed? Any questions? Okay, good. So what is HD now? What is HD? Now I can play the same game now in this way also. In order to know HD, okay, I already know this angle. This angle is 90 minus B. And I already know this side. Right? What is this side? What is this side? This side is B cos C. Correct. So what is HD length? What is HD length? So HD by B cos C, so I will write it over here. HD by B cos C is tan of 90 minus B. Correct? So HD is cot B into B cos C. Oh God. Sorry, I was disconnected. Can you all hear me? Okay, can you all see my screen? So HD will be what? HD will be, so HD by B cos C is tan of this angle. Tan of this angle is this. So I've written it as cot B. So I took the B cos C on the top and I also converted cot B as cos B by sine B. Okay. Now, all of you, please pay attention here. AH is known. HD is known. Okay. And one very important thing, you can write it in a very simple term. C by sine C is actually 2R. Okay. And this is equal to 2R cos B cos C. Correct? So this is also 2R. This is also 2R. Oh, sorry. Okay. So AH by HD is equal to, now this question mark becomes cos A by cos B cos C. Okay. Now how do I solve this? Because I need this in the ratio of tan. I need this in the ratio of tan. So what will you do in this case? Now, all of you, please pay attention. I will multiply this with sine A on the top and sine A in the bottom, in the denominator. Okay. I'm moving very slowly over here. In case you have any doubt, please feel free to stop me. Okay. No doubt till this point of time. Now, sine A, I can write it, let me write it on top. Sine A, I can write it as sine B plus C. Okay. Sine B plus C expansion, you can write. I'll write it in shortcut. Sine B cos C, and again multiply with a cos A, plus cos B sine C, again multiply with a cos A. Whole thing is divided by sine A cos B cos C. Okay. If you literally bring the division, if you literally make the division happen, you would realize that when this term gets divided by this, you will get rid of, what does it become? What does this become? Is the expansion clear? I mean, I hope you have written the expansion correctly. Oh, yeah. What does it become? Okay. Don't divide it like this. Then divide by cos A, cos B, cos C. Divided by cos A, cos B, cos C. Okay. If you do that, you will end up getting tan A, check here. This will give you, sorry, tan B. This will give you a tan C, and this will give you a tan A in the denominator. Tan A in the denominator. Okay. So basically it will become tan B plus tan C by tan A. By tan A. Correct? So now what have you figured out? You figured out that AH is to HD. This is to this is known to you right now. So let me make a third triangle. So let me make a third triangle over here. Yeah. I will not write a lot of stuff over here. I'll just write H, D, and A. So this is your X1, Y1. This point was, correct me if I'm wrong, X2 tan B, X3 tan C by tan B plus tan C, comma Y2 tan B, Y3 tan C by tan B plus tan C. Okay. And this ratio was tan B plus tan C is to tan A. So what will be the coordinate of H? So anybody can now tell me the coordinate of H. So it will be this multiplied with your X coordinate, tan A multiplied with the X coordinate of A, and then add the ratio. So overall, if you see, it will become, I'll just write first tan A into X1, which will make it as X A tan A. And if this guy tan B plus C multiplies to this, tan B plus C will get cancelled off. Okay, so leaving you with this. Divided by sum of these two. Sum of these two will be tan A plus tan B plus tan C. Similarly, Y also you have to copy in the same way. And this is our required formula. Treat this as a learning. Of course, these coordinates may not be very helpful to you, but treat this as how to deal with a geometry problem within a coordinate geometry. Okay. So let's now move on to the next concept, which is area of a polygon. Area of a polygon. When the coordinates are given, when the coordinates of the vertices are given, coordinates of the vertices are known. You would have all learnt your area of a triangle, isn't it? How do you find the area of a triangle when the vertices coordinates are known? Can somebody tell me what is the... So let's say I have a triangle whose coordinates are known to me. Okay. Let's say X1, Y1, X2, Y2 and X3, Y3. What is the area of the triangle you have learned? Right. So you have learned that area of the triangle ABC in your class 10th, I'm sure you would have learned this. It is half mod x1 y2 minus y3 plus x2 y3 minus y1 plus x3 y2 minus y1. Correct? Okay, is this the formula you have learned in your class 10th? Yes or no? Three one two. Correct? Is this fine? There's a cyclic nature in this. 1, 2, 3. That's how I also remembered when I was a student. 1, 2, 3, 2, 3, 1, then 3, 1, 2. Absolutely correct. Okay. Now, how did you get this answer? Did you ever try to question your teacher? How did you get this answer? Did you ever try to ask your teacher, how did you get this answer? No determinal and all. Right, Dev, absolutely. So basically you dropped perpendiculars onto the x-axis, okay, like this, and it created trapeziums for you, isn't it? So if you see, there is two trapezium, in fact, three trapezium created over here. Let me name it as, let's say, ABC, PQR. Okay. So can I say area of the triangle ABC will be area of the trapezium BAQP plus area of the trapezium ACRQ. Okay. Minus area of the trapezium, which is down in the base over here, which is actually BCRP. Yes or no? This is how you get it. Correct? So, how do you find the area of a trapezium? Area of a trapezium is half into height into sum of the parallel sides, isn't it? Okay. So, when you perform that, you get this answer, which I'm not interested in getting right now. Okay. You can easily confirm from here. Okay. That this is going to be your answer. Correct? Now, I will tell you some shortcut way to get this. Okay. I'm sure you would have learned this in your class 10th. Tushar sir would have taught you something which we call as the staircase method. Staircase method, or many books will call it as the shoelace method. Okay. So this expression that you have, see, when I was basically solving it, I had, you know, by mistake written y2 minus y1 over here. So there was an element of confusion. Okay. And it can happen in you also. It is very obvious, right? Our brain may not remember all the formulae, you know, throughout our entire preparation time, isn't it? Hello, can you hear me? Hello? Am I audible? Can you hear me? Hello? Okay, fine. Okay. Can you see my screen as well? Can you see my screen? All of you can see my screen? Okay. Sorry, there was a power fluctuation from my end. I'm extremely sorry about that. Yes, now there is a method which we call as the staircase method or the shoelace method, which says you can easily find out the area of the triangle by using this simple trick. So write down the coordinates like this: x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3, and then back to x1, y1. Okay, so this method says area of the triangle is given by, just do this operation. The meaning of this symbol is you have to do this operation. Multiply this with this, multiply this with this, multiply this with this. Okay. So first write that down. So x1, y2, x2, y3, x3, y1. Okay. Then multiply these guys. Okay. And just write it in the same way as you had done for the yellow ones. So x2, y1, x3, y2 plus x1, y3, and subtract the two results. Okay. You may have to take a mod in this case. Okay. So you understood what I did here. I multiplied x1, y2. I wrote here. I multiplied x2, y3. I wrote here. I multiplied x3, y1. I wrote over here. Then I multiplied x2, y1. I wrote over here. I multiplied x3, y2. Okay, and I wrote over here, and I multiplied x1, y3, and I wrote over here. So the yellow ones minus the white ones would be your area of the triangle. Okay. Now this rule basically is nothing but it's an observation from this answer itself. Okay. If you see this answer, you have written x1, y2. See, there is an x1, y2 here. You have written x2, y3. See, there is an x2, y3 over here. You have written x3, y1. See, there is an x3, y1 over here. Then you have written minus x1, y3. Minus x1, y3. If you open the bracket, it becomes minus x1, y3. Here is also minus x1, y3. See, last term, minus x1, y3. Then you have a minus x2, y1. Then minus x2, y1. And then you have minus x3, y2. And then you have a minus x3, y2. Okay. So I basically remember this staircase method. And this always this always helps me to get my answer right. Okay. Now, one small thing I would like to highlight over here. If you take your coordinates of the triangle in such a way, if you take your coordinates of the triangle in such a way that while moving from x1, y1 to x2, y2, and x2, y3 to x3, y3, and from x3, y3 to y3, x3, y1. So while moving from x1, y1 to x2, y2, while moving from x2, y2 to x3, y3, and from x3, y3 to x1, y1, your area is always to your left-hand side. Okay, let's say you are walking on this path. Okay. So when you're walking on this path, this area is always on your left-hand side. Okay, then your answer for this quantity will always come out to be positive. You don't have to take a mod. Now, why does it happen? It is because when you take this, we basically follow something which we call as the right hand thumb rule. Now, see my right hand. Okay, this is my right hand. You try to move along the arrow direction. So if you move along the arrow direction, you will realize that the thumb is coming towards your face. Okay. When thumb is coming outside, it is a positive area. When thumb is going inside, it will be a negative area. Let's say if I go from this direction, let's say I go from B to A to C. So if I go in this direction, then what will happen? Try to curl your finger in the direction of the arrow. Okay. Naturally. You'll see that your thumb is going inside the plane of the laptop or the computer which you're using. In that case, your answer would come out to be negative. Okay. So when our teacher used to tell us in our junior classes that put a mod, she basically thought that you would take it in a random fashion and you can get both positive or negative of your value. That's why as a precautionary measure, she told you to take a mod. But in reality, if you take your coordinates, let's say if you arrange them on the xy coordinate axis, and you always take x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3 in such a way that while moving from A to B, B to C, C to A, your area is always towards your left hand side. That means you're following the right hand thumb rule. Then there's no need to take a mod. Your answer will automatically come out to be positive. Are you getting my point? Okay, so please note down this so that we can start applying it. Okay, so now the topic name was area of a polygon. I just gave you area of a triangle. So can we use the same or can we generalize the same even for a n-sided polygon? If yes, how does this rule change and what is the shortcut for getting the answer? So the shortcut for getting the area of a polygon, so let me generalize it over here. So if you have a n-sided polygon, okay, I'm not drawing all the vertices. Okay, let's say I put a dot, dot, dot. So if you have, let's say x1, y1, x2, y2, dot, 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 and let's say this length, this was your x, n, y, n. Okay. What is the area of this polygon? Area of this polygon as per the shoelace formula will become half mod of, or you can write mod outside, mod of this structure, x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3, till you reach xn, yn, and at the end you have to write x1, y1 again. Okay, so this is something which is important. Please do not forget, at the last you are writing x1, y1 again, right? So this also will go like this, x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3, till xn, y1, and at the end you'll have x1, y1 again. Then again do these multiplications which I told you, okay, like this, write them down, and then do these other ones, okay, write them down, subtract both the results, take half, factor of half, and mod it if you are getting a negative answer. If your area is always taken in such a way that it is following the right hand thumb rule, that means if you are going from x1, y1, x2, y3 in such a way that your thumb is coming towards your face, then you'll always get a positive answer. Don't worry about that. Is this fine? So shoelace method is a very, very time efficient way to get our answer. Later on, we learn that there is something called determinant also, which basically comes from the same similar idea. Let's take a question. Question is, find the area of the quadrilateral ABCD whose vertices are given to you. Okay, I'll try my best to, you know, plot the point as close as possible. Let's say 1 comma 1 is here. This is your A. 7 comma minus 3. 7 comma minus 3 will come down. So 7 comma minus 3. So B will come over here. C is 12 comma 2. So 12 comma 2 will still come up there. This is C. And D is 7 comma 21. 7 comma 21 will be somewhere over here. Okay, I'm just rough. Okay. So this is 1 comma 1. 1 comma 1, this is 7 comma minus 3, 12 comma 2, 7 comma 21. This is my quadrilateral. Yeah. Yes, Ananya, I'll show it again. This is the general formula. X1, Y1, X2, Y2, X3, Y3, so on till Xn, Yn, and X1, Y1 again. Got it? Okay, now take this in such a way that you are always taking these points in such a way that as you move from x1, y1 to x2, y2, let's say I call this as x1, y1. So let me begin with this as x1, y1. This is x2, y2. This as x3, y3. And this as x4, y4. So when I'm going from A to B, B to C, C to D, D to A again, your area is always on the left side. So you'll see that you will not require a mod. You will not require a mod. Very good, Archit. Archit has got it. Okay, so half, see here, those who have not followed the formula, very good, Ruchita. So let's say I write 721 first. Okay, then 11. Okay, it's better to write a lighter figure on the top because you'll repeat the same thing again. Doesn't make much of a difference, by the way. So 11. Then you write 7 minus 3. Then you write 7 minus 3. Then you write 12, 2. Okay. Then you write 721. Then you write 11 again. Okay. So please see how this is expanded. So first multiply the ones which I'm showing with the green sign. This with this, this with this, this with this, this with this. Okay. So let me write it down. Half. Yeah. So minus 3 plus 14. How much is 21 into 12? 21 into 12. This is 42, 12, 162. Okay. And 7. This will come under one umbrella minus. Now multiply these guys. This with this, this with this, this with this, this with this. So this will become a 7 minus 36 plus 14 plus 21. Okay. So this will give you, let's simplify this. I think 14 will get cancelled. Even 7 will get cancelled. So 7, 14 will get cancelled. So you'll end up getting, this is 159 and this is plus 15. Okay. How much is this? Oh, sorry. This is 21. This is 252. Oh, ho, 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 ho. 252. So this is 249. Thank you. So this gives you a 264 by 2. 264 by 2 is 132 square units. Okay. As you will see here, I have never taken a mod. This is what I was talking about. If you're translating on the figure in such a way that area is always, let's say you're walking. Let's say this is a lawn. Okay. Let's say this is a, you know, garden on which you're, on whose roads you're walking. If your garden is always on your left side as you're walking, then that area that will come out will automatically be positive. You don't have to make a separate mod thing for that. Are you getting my point? Okay, so 132 square units. I hope everybody has got it. No doubt, no concerns here. Any questions? Okay, let's move on to the next concept, next problem, by the way. I'll give you a break after this. Okay. Read this question carefully. After this question, Prakul, I'll give you a break. P, Q and R points are as given to you. P is 2, 3. R is 4, -2. Sorry, Q is 4, -2. R is alpha, 0. Find the value of alpha if PR plus RQ is minimum. Let's do the first question. All of you, please first focus on the first part. Sorry, we have to take directions into consideration here. Why would you take a direction into consideration? Oh, you're talking about PR being a directed length. No, 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 no. Here it is just a length. Okay. See, there's no vector sign on top of it, Ruchita. Okay. So you can take it as a length. Okay. So I got an answer from Archit. We'll see, Archit. So P is here, Q is somewhere over here. Okay. And R, I believe, is somewhere over here. Yeah. Very good, Ananya. Very good, Ruchita. Come on, guys. Shambho, are you there? Amruta, Adarsh, Akshat, Aryan Jha, Aryan Kumar. Gauri, Titiksha, yeah, I was about to take your name, Titiksha. Okay. See, guys, first part is very easy. Okay. If you want your PR plus RQ to be minimum, right? Common sense says that it can only happen when PR and Q are in a straight line. Correct? Isn't it? Okay. Or anyways, also, if you see, if you apply triangle inequality, can I say by triangle inequality, in any triangle, the sum of two sides is always greater than equal to, okay, the third side. So PR plus RQ will always be greater than PQ, correct? What does it mean? It means the minimum value of PR plus RQ will be equal to PQ. Will be equal to PQ. Correct. So PR plus RQ will be minimum when P, R and Q are in the straight line. That means R should actually be here. This is the actual position of R. Okay. Yes or no? Common sense says that. Correct. Isn't it? So if P, R and Q are in the straight line, if P, R, Q are collinear, what does it imply? It implies that the area of the triangle P, R, Q must be zero. Okay, let's make a shoelace formula over here. So 2, 3, 4, minus 2, alpha 0, 2, 3, this should be zero. Correct? Yes or no? Right? So this means what? Half. Okay. Let's multiply these guys first. Tau, tau, tau. So this will be minus 4, 0, 3 alpha. Now let's multiply these guys. 12 minus 2 alpha. 12 minus 2 alpha. This should be 0. Correct? That means 3 alpha minus 4 minus 12 plus 2 alpha should be 0. That means 5 alpha should be 16. Alpha is 16 by 5. There are a few people who gave me this answer. Let me check who were there. Ruchita gave me. Very good, Ruchita. I think before that, Ananya gave. Ananya Raghunandan. Awesome. Very nice. This was not a very easy question, actually. Okay. Good. Any question, any concerns with this first part? All of you are happy with this? Can we move on to the second part, please? Any questions, please highlight. Okay. Second part, find alpha if you want PR minus RQ mod. That is the difference of PR and RQ to be maximum. Let's see who gets it. Guys, some of you have asked me, will the classes happen during the term 1 exam? See, if you have a gap on the next day, let's say today is Thursday and Friday there is no exam, okay, then it will be a 3.5 hour session as it happens normally, okay. But if there is an exam on the next day and there is a centum on the previous day, then we'll keep the class duration as just 2 hours, but without any break. Will that be fine? Any modification or any suggestion that you would like to give there? Have you understood what I've said just now? If there is a gap on the next day, no exam on the next day, then full 3.5 hour session. But if there is a exam on the next day, whether it is for NAFL people or for Rajaji Nagar people, the class will happen only for 2 hours. For use or you'd all be different, right? I didn't get your. For us, whichever school has an exam will give the benefit of doubt to both the schools. Don't worry. Could you repeat the right hand? Yes. See, what I said was, I think that is not going to help you in this case, Meghna. I'm just giving you the idea. However, see. If you want area of a triangle whose coordinates are known to you, let's say this is x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3. Okay. Let's say you arranged it in a xy coordinate system. Okay. And if you don't want to use mod, let's say I don't want to use mod, then I should name it, I should take x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3 in such a way that as I'm moving from A to B, B to C, C to A, my area should always be on the left side of my hand. Let's say I'm a person who's walking on this path. Okay. So I'm walking. So this is my right hand. This is my left hand. Correct. Let's say I'm putting my hand like this. I'm walking on this thing. If the area always is on my left side, see the movement of my hand, then the answer doesn't require a mod. That is what I was trying to say. Alternately, if you curl your finger in the direction of the arrow, take your right hand. You can see the arrow being made on the triangle. Just move your finger along that arrow. Then see your thumb will always come out. If that is always coming out, then you don't require a mod in your formula. It'll automatically be positive. Very good, Ananya. Awesome. You cracked it. Sorry, let me show you the question. Question got hidden actually, yes. Find the value of alpha if PR minus RQ is maximum. Yeah, Akshat, I have got your message before also. I mean, the last time you messaged me was, I lost that because I got disconnected, no, in between. No, previous question, you didn't answer anything, to at least to me. I got from Archit, Ruchita, Ananya, Ruchita, Titiksha, Madhumati, Ritu, Madhumati again. Now I'm getting your answers, don't worry. Okay, good. Anusha, good. Titiksha, good. Chalo, let's discuss it. I don't want to take away your break time. So let me redraw this figure once again. Let me redraw the figure. Akshat, very good. Now I got your answer. So let me redraw the figure once again. P 2, 3, Q. What was Q? 4, -2, if I'm not mistaken, 4, -2. And R is somewhere. I don't know where is R. R is somewhere. Okay. So let's say R is here. Okay. You want PR minus RQ to be maximum. Isn't it? PR minus RQ to be maximum. Okay. Now, let us make the mirror image of Q about the x-axis. So let's say this is the mirror image of Q about the x-axis, which is Q dash. So Q dash coordinate will be 4, 2. Right? Oh yeah, there are two Akshat. Who is the second Akshat? No. There's two Akshat D. Okay. Let it be Akshat. We'll figure out who is a person. I'm just tracking the IP of that person. Yeah. He left the call. Okay. Yeah. So what I was saying, let's say Q dash is the mirror image of Q about the x-axis. Now all of you please focus here. Can I say if Q dash is the mirror image of Q about the x-axis, this length and this length would be the same? Correct? So RQ would be RQ dash. Okay. Now, so if I have to find out the maximum of this, that means I have to find out the maximum of this guy. So what is the maximum of this guy? That is what we want to find out. Correct. Now, why did I take a mirror image is for this reason that, now look at the triangle. Look at the triangle P R Q dash. Okay, so focus on this triangle. Can I say in any triangle, the difference of two sides will always be lesser than equal to the third side, which is RQ dash. Oh, sorry. PR minus RQ will be PQ dash. Yes or no? Okay. Now, if you want your mod PR minus RQ to be maximum. See, it is always less than equal to this. So if you want it to be maximum, then PR minus RQ dash mod should be equal to PQ dash, because PQ dash is the maximum value that this can take. Okay. Now, if somebody says PR minus RQ is giving you PQ dash, what does it mean in that case? It means that your P, Q dash and R, they will become collinear. See, what is the meaning of this term? If you're saying PR minus RQ dash is PQ dash, that is, see, let me remove my camera. PR minus RQ dash is equal to PQ dash. It can only happen when PRQ dash or PQ dash R are collinear. So this means P, Q dash and R are collinear. Correct? Yes or no? If they are collinear, can I say area of the triangle formed by P, Q dash R must be zero? Correct. So half, let's use the shoelace method. What is the coordinate of P? P is 2, 3. What is the coordinate of Q dash? 4, 2. What is the coordinate of R? α, 0. So basically, this is what I'm going to use. Correct? So let us expand it. So 4, 0, 3, α. So it's 4 + 3α. Minus 12 + 2α. This should be 0. In other words, -8 + α should be 0. Alpha should be equal to 8. So this is going to be your answer. Is that fine? Is that fine? Any questions? Any concerns? Clear? Dev? Okay. So, time for a break now. Let's have a break. Right now, the time on my system is 6:32, but I'll give you a few grace seconds. 6:33 p.m. Let's meet at 6:48 p.m. Kinshuk, I'm not looking at your messages. Okay. Thank you. Let's meet at exactly 6:48. All right. I hope you people are back. Back. Okay. All right. Next concept that we are going to talk about is the concept of shifting of origin. This is the same concept that we had learned in our bridge course also when we talked about, you know, transformation of graphs. Is my voice echoing? Is my voice fine? Can you all hear me properly? Kind of. Okay. Kind of. Okay. It's fine for Sinchen. Okay, fine. So shifting of origin is basically a concept where you try to, you know, shift your origin in such a way that you meet or you basically solve a given question with less effort. It's a concept which is very badly dealt with in school. In fact, in many of the schools, they don't even talk about it. But without this concept, it will be very difficult to solve questions, especially related to the concept of homogenization. Now, what is this homogenization? I'm using several terms over here, which probably you have not heard of. You will hear it in a very quick time when we are doing more of coordinate geometry, especially when we are doing pair of straight lines. So what is this concept? What is the concept of shifting of origin? See, let us say if you are talking about a point 2, 3, or let's say I talk about a point 5, 6. Okay. What is the meaning of this 5 and meaning of this 6? 5 basically represents what is the distance of a point from the y-axis. And 6 represents what is the distance from the x-axis, correct? Basically, you have fixed your origin somewhere, and with respect to this as your reference point, this coordinate is 5/6. Okay, no doubt about it. Let us say I decide to choose a different point as my origin. Let's say I make another coordinate axis over here. Now this is my new x-axis, let's say capital X, and this is my new y-axis, let's say capital Y. Okay. If I say, now my new origin, instead of O, has now become O dash. Now this O dash is located at, let's say, 1, 3. What do you think would be the coordinates for the same point P? What do you think would be the new coordinates for the same point P? So will it remain 5, 6 or will it change? Will it remain 5, 6 or will it change? Of course it will change, right? How will it change? How will it change? So if you are basically bringing your origin to 1, 3 means you are shifting one to the origin, one to the right and three up, right? That means you are coming one closer in the x-axis and three closer in the y-axis. So now the same point will now be 4, 3. Absolutely, Dev. That will become 4, 3. Correct. So remember, when you are shifting your origin, the same position will now be known by a different coordinate. Are you getting my point? So I have not displaced P anywhere, but since I've displaced my origin, my point P would be known by a different coordinate altogether. My point P will be known by a different coordinate altogether. Okay. So shifting of origin will make coordinates change. It will make equations change. But remember, it will not make dimensions change. Are you getting my point? What is the meaning of dimension? For example, let's say if I'm talking about a circle. If I shift the circle anywhere in the space, of course, its equation will keep on changing. Its center coordinates will keep on changing. But what will never change is the length of its radius. Correct. So shifting of origin basically brings about a change in the coordinates. It will bring about a change in the equation, but it will never bring about a change in the dimension of that particular figure unless until the dimension is related to the origin. For example, if you want to find out the distance of the center from the origin, probably that will change. Okay. So whatever we did just now, can we generalize this? Can we give it a more generic structure? So let us say I have a point x comma y, small x comma y. Okay. And let's say this is your origin. Okay. Now I decide to shift my origin in such a way that there is no rotation happening of any kind. That means my new x-axis is still parallel to the old one. My new y-axis is still parallel to the old one. So from this point 0, 0, I brought it to this point, let's say O dash, which is H, K. So very same point P, what will be the new coordinates over here? So you'll say the new coordinate would be nothing but small x minus H and small y minus K. In other words, your earlier x coordinate is the new x coordinate plus H. And your earlier y coordinate is your new y coordinate plus k. This is something that you need to keep in your mind. Okay, so if you shift your origin to h comma k, your small x will get replaced with capital X plus h, and your small y will get replaced with capital Y plus k. Are you getting this point? Okay. Now, this is something which will help you in also changing the equation of a curve. So if you had a curve y equal to f of x, okay, when your origin was at 0, 0, let's say if you shift your origin to h comma k, how would the equation of the curve get changed? So if you follow this, your y will get replaced with y plus k, and your x will get replaced with x plus h, something very similar to what we did in our bridge course, right? So now people ask me, sir, in bridge course, when you're shifting something to h comma k, we actually replaced, when the curve got shifted by h to the right and k to the up, we replace our x with x minus h and y with y minus k, right? Basically, you're doing the same thing over here, but in from a different perspective. See, if I have a parabola. I'll just take a simple example because parabola is something that you have done to a very large extent in your bridge course. Okay, let's say vertex is at origin. Okay, if I shift my parabola like this, such that the vertex now becomes, in fact, the vertex now becomes, let's say 2, 1. How would the equation of this parabola change? What would be the equation of this white parabola? You have shifted the curve 2 units to the right, 1 unit to the top. What will be the equation of the parabola? No, Prakul, that's not right. By the way, this is x square is equal to 4ay. My bad. Yeah, x square is equal to 4y. Yeah. How would it change? Tell me. So you'll replace your x with x minus 2. And y will get replaced with y minus 1. Correct? This is what you had learned. Correct. Now, actually, what is happening here, which I didn't tell you in the bridge course, because you would not be able to appreciate it at that point of time. Your curve is not shifting. Our origin is shifting, actually. So this yellow curve remained wherever it is. It's just that I brought the origin 2 units to left and 1 unit down. Are you getting my point? So in this case, your origin got shifted to minus 2 comma minus 1. Guys, it is not the curve which is shifting. See, curve will remain as it is. Origin got shifted from here to here. Are you getting my point? I think my picture is the mirror image of what actually I wanted to do. So let's say the origin is here. Let's say origin is here. This is my origin over here. The curve shifted, actually, origin shifted over here. Are you getting my point? So if your origin got shifted to h, comma k, this is your h and this is your k, then what do we normally do? We replace our x with x plus h and we replace our y with y plus k. And that is what you actually told me. So both the answers are actually the same, but just seen from a different point of view. You see it as a shift of the curve. I see it as a shift of the origin. And that time also, if you go and watch those videos back, you would see many a times I have used this word. It is not the curve which is moving. It is actually the origin which is moving. Okay. Are you getting my point? So let's say I want to know the distance. If I want to increase the distance of wall from me, obviously I cannot move the wall. I have to move backward. No. No, Dev. If the curve has to move top and right, origin has to move down and left. Getting my point? So think that your white curve is actually your yellow curve only. And origin got shifted. Yeah, I'll repeat once again. See, earlier your diagram was like this, right? Correct. Now let's say the curve is here only. I shift my origin to this position. Getting my point? So isn't this now the white diagram that you have seen over here? So this is what I'm connecting to this guy. And this is what I'm connecting to this guy. Ah, got it now. So curve doesn't shift. I'm repeating it again. Curve doesn't shift. So in bridge course, try to recall. Bridge course, what did I say? When you shift the curve right by h unit, you replace your x with x minus h. Correct? Remember? But it is in reality, the curve is not shifting h units to the right. Origin is shifting h units to the left. Correct? So origin is going to minus h comma 0. So your capital X, as you can see from the formula, your capital X will be small x. Your small x will be capital X plus h. So your new coordinate will be capital X. So it will be capital X minus h will come there because you're shifting to the left. Okay. Anyways, I have not written any sign to h and k over here because h and k can be positive, negative, any of the quantity. Just keep this formula in your mind. Small x is capital X plus h. Small y is capital Y plus k. Nothing else you need to remember. Nothing else you need to remember. Okay. So with this formula, you can find anything you want. You can find the new equations to the curve. See, when the coordinates axes shift, when your origin shifts, your equations will undergo a change. How will that change? That is decided by this formula. Okay. Let's take a few questions to understand this. Okay. Guys, get this right, else there will always be this sign confusion. There will always be a sign confusion if you don't get this right today. Question is, at what point should the origin be shifted if you want 4,5 to become minus 3,9? So see, this is your x, y. This is your capital X, capital Y. And just remember that relation. Capital X is small x, or you can say small x is capital X plus H. Let me write it in the reverse way. Capital X plus H is your small x, and capital Y plus K is your small y. This is your formula which you need to remember in your mind. Okay. So 4 is equal to minus 3 plus H. And 5 is equal to 9 plus k. Okay. So your h will become a 7. Your k will become a minus 4. Answer would be your origin must be shifted. Your origin must be shifted to 7, minus 4. 7, minus 4. Absolutely correct, Inshu. Is this clear? Is this clear? Any questions here? Okay. Just remember, small x is capital X plus H. Small y is capital Y plus K. This is the formula that you need to remember for your shift of origin. Let's take another question. Now, this all cases that I'm telling is when your origin has, when your axes have not been rotated. Okay, you are not rotating your axes. I will talk about rotation also in some time. Okay, so let's do this question. If the origin is shifted to 1, minus 2 without rotation of axes, what do the following equations become? Let us first do this one. Everybody, please try it for 1.5 minutes, then we'll discuss it. Done first one? Nothing. Why will you complete the square here? What is the formula which I told? Small x is capital X plus H. Small y is capital Y plus K. That's it. This is what is. Okay. Okay. So now you have to replace your small x with capital X plus H. What is H here? What is H? H is 1. You have to replace your small y with capital Y plus K. K is what? Minus 2. Getting it? So when you do that change in the first one, you get 2x plus 1 the whole square plus y minus 2 the whole square minus 4x plus 1 plus 4y minus 2. Simple. Just simplify it. So if you simplify it, you get 2x square. You will get minus 2x. Okay. In fact, let me write y square terms first before I write anything else. You will get y square. This will give you 4x. 4x will get cancelled off. Minus 4y and 4y, that will also get cancelled off. And you will be left with 2 here, 4 here, minus 4 here, minus 8 here. Oh. This will give you 2x square plus y square is equal to 6. Is that fine? Did anybody get that answer? Everybody got this answer? Anybody who got a different answer, please let me know. Clear? Okay. Try the second question. Similar way. Second question. Y square minus 4x plus 4y plus 8. So what will you do? Y minus 2 square minus 4x plus 1 plus 4y minus 2 plus 8. Okay. Let's expand. So y square minus 4y plus 4y will get cancelled off. Then you'll get minus 4x. Okay. And 4 here and 4 here will get cancelled off. 8 here and 8 here will get cancelled off. So it'll just give you y square minus 4x equal to 0. Is this fine? Does it make sense? Clear? Okay. We'll do more questions. Don't worry. Enough questions we'll take. Okay. Find the equation to which this equation is transformed if the origin is shifted to 2 comma minus 3, the axis remaining parallel to the original axis. That means there is no rotation happening, guys. If rotation comes into picture, the formula will change completely, which I will deal in some time. Okay. Let's not simplify it. Let's not waste time simplifying it. Just give me the raw form of the expression without simplification. Okay, I think it'll be too much for you to type also. What should I replace X with and what should I replace Y with? At least tell me that. What should I replace X with? Write like this. X plus minus what? And Y, sorry. Y should be replaced with? Right. X should be replaced with capital X plus 2. Y should be replaced with Y minus 3. Absolutely. So when you simplify it, you have to write your result like this. Of course, I don't want you to waste time doing it. It's a futile effort. Once you have understood this, there is no point wasting time doing it. Okay, minus 26 y minus 3 minus 60 equal to 0. Achha, one small thing I would like to add over here, which I forgot to add here. Normally, we don't leave our answer in terms of capital X and capital Y. Okay, have you ever seen any equation written in capital X and capital Y, right? So what we do is we gently convert x to small x and y to small y. Okay. So capital X and capital Y was only written for you to make a distinction between the old equation and the new equation. Correct. But when we are representing our final answer to the examiner, we have to use small alphabets only. Got the point? So don't write things in capital X and capital Y. Okay. It is not a norm to write any equation in terms of capital X and capital Y. Okay, let's take one more question. Yeah, this one. So there was a curve. The equation of a curve referred to the new axis. Yeah, refer to the new axis retaining their direction and origin being 4,5 is given by this. Now they have written it in a capital letter just to tell you that this is the new equation. This is the new set of, this is the new equation for you. Now they're asking you, what was the original equation? What was the equation referred to the original axis? You got the question? No. So there was some curve. There you replace your x with capital X plus 4 and y with capital Y plus 5. And you got this answer. So what was the old curve that they're asking you? Absolutely, Prakul. Very good. Correct. So see, small x is capital X plus H and small y is capital Y plus K. Means capital X is small x minus H and capital Y is small y minus K. Correct. So you replace your capital X with small x minus 4 and capital Y with small y minus 5. That's it. Story is over. So answer is x minus 4 the whole square, y minus 5 the whole square is 36. Simple as that. Clear? Any questions, any concerns with shifting of origin? So this is the formula, only formula which you need to remember, and all your custa will be taken care of. Okay, chalo, good. Next concept, in the next 17 minutes, I'm going to talk about a very, very important concept, rotation of axes. Okay. So as we all know that XY coordinates basically depends upon its distance from the reference axis, which we call as the X and Y axis, right? So any point P, basically we refer its coordinate by stating its distance from the X axis and the Y axis. Okay. Now, of course, shifting of origin will change it. But not only that, if you rotate it, that will also change your coordinates of a point. So let's say I have rotated my coordinate axis by an angle of theta degree anti-clockwise. So let's say I rotated my coordinate axis to new position, capital X and capital Y, by rotating it by an angle of theta. That means this is also theta. Won't the coordinate of the same point P change? Won't it become some different coordinate? Yes? Yes or no? Why? Because, of course, earlier this was your Y and this was your X. Correct. This was your X and this was your Y. Now, this is your Y and this is your X. Correct. Of course, they will change and hence the coordinate will also change. So how will it change is something that we are going to now figure out in the next 15 minutes. Okay. So now pay attention over here. This is a very important concept. Very, very important concept. I will remove all unnecessary things over here. Okay. Whatever I don't need. For this, I will take help of the polar coordinates, the one which was given by Newton. Okay. So let's say this point P, let me connect it with the origin. Okay. Let's say I call this distance as R. So this distance is R. Okay. And let's say I call this angle as phi. Okay. Now, Newton said that you can locate a point by referring to its distance from the pole, which is the origin right now in your case, and by giving this angle, which is phi in this case. And how is this polar coordinate connected to the Cartesian coordinate? We know that X is R cos phi and Y is R sine phi. I think we have been learning this since trigonometry days. Not a surprise to us, correct? Yes or no? Now let us say I rotate my coordinate axis theta degree anti-clockwise, correct? So now think as if your X and the Y axes have become these white lines, as you can see. Now what is this angle? this Chotu angle. What is this angle? You'll say, sir, obviously it will be phi minus theta. Correct. Yes or no? Correct. Does it change the distance from the pole by rotation? Does it change the distance from the pole? Does rotating coordinate axis change the distance of the point from the pole? No. It'll still remain r then. This distance will still remain r. So can I say by the very same logic by which we connected x, r and phi and y, r and phi, I can say capital X will be r cos phi minus theta. And capital Y will be r sine phi minus theta. Correct? Yes or no? Is there any doubt regarding these two? Then please stop me. Clear? No problem? No concerns? Okay. Now let us work on these terms. I will start expanding it. So if you start expanding it, this will give you r cos phi cos theta plus r sine phi sine theta. Correct? So I just expanded this guy. So expand the other term also, it will become r sine phi cos theta minus r cos phi sine theta. Got it? Don't worry, those terms will come up. Those terms will come up. Don't worry about that. Prakul, those terms will automatically come up. Okay. Now, all of you please pay attention. All of you please pay attention. What is this guy? This guy is small x. See here. See here. R cos alpha, R cos phi is small x, right? What is this guy? This guy is small y. What is this guy? Again small y. What is this guy? Again small x. Correct? So what did we learn from this exercise? We learned that the new x coordinate will be old x coordinate cos theta plus old y coordinate sine theta. And new y coordinate will be old y coordinate, or you can write this first. Negative of old x coordinate sine theta plus the old y coordinate cos theta. Okay. More importantly, which I am giving up to you, leaving up to you for your homework, your small x is actually capital X cos theta minus y sine theta, and your old y coordinate was your new x coordinate sine theta plus new y coordinate cos theta. This formula is what I want you to remember. This is more important than the previous one. This is more important than this one. Why this is more important is because most of the questions will come asking you what is the new equation. Okay. So new equation of curves, if you want to find out, this formula will be useful. If you want to find new coordinates, then this formula will be useful. So this is important if you want to find out the new equation, which is more commonly asked. And this is important when you want to find out the new coordinates. Now, how is this transition from here to here? That is something which I am leaving up for you to do as a homework question. Okay. Sir, in the box form, the first equation was small y. Yes, my dear, it was small y. I've just shifted it. I've changed the position. No, see it carefully, Ritu. This was y, no? Y cos theta, I've kept it over here. This was minus x sine theta, I've kept it over here. I just swapped the positions.
Sorry?
Yes.
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yes, tell me.
Sir, in the boxed formula that you've put for the new equation.
Yes.
You've written x is equal to capital X cos theta minus small y sin theta.
Yes.
So small y, sir.
Yeah. No. Sorry. Capital Y. All of them are capital Y. Oh, thank you. Thank you for bringing it to my notice. Yeah, sorry. But the sign will change. This minus sign will actually come over here. This plus sign will come over here. So these two signs will interchange their positions. Okay. Anyways, I'm leaving up to you to prove it. It's very easy. You just have to multiply that equation with cos theta, this with sin theta, and subtract it. You'll get small x. Okay. Similarly, multiply this with sin theta, this with cos theta, and add it. You'll get small y. Okay. That you can do for homework. Now, let us understand this formula through problem practice. Let's take few problems. We still have 8 minutes left. We can take at least one problem in this time limit. Let us take the question. Yeah. Question is, the equation of the curve referred to the given system of axes is as shown on your screen. Okay. Find the equation if the axes are rotated by 45 degrees, the origin remaining unchanged. Now, guys, one small thing I would like to bring it to your notice before you solve this question. We'll go back. This formula was derived when your coordinate axes were rotated theta degree anti-clockwise. Does it mean I will have a different formula if it was rotated clockwise? No. If it is rotated anti-clockwise, theta is positive. Okay, so theta is positive for anti-clockwise rotation. So if the question just says 45 degree means it is by default anti-clockwise. Okay, and you'll take theta as negative. I'll write it down here with yellow. Negative if you are rotating it clockwise. Okay, so formula is not going to change. It is the same formula that you're going to follow. It's just that when it is clockwise, when your axes are rotated clockwise, you'll keep theta as positive value. That's a plus 45 degree. Had the same question been if you rotated 45 degree, anti-clockwise positive, clockwise negative. Okay. So in this case, the problem that we have over here, they have just written 45 degrees. 45 degrees means clockwise, anti-clockwise 45 degrees. So this means anti-clockwise 45 degrees. Okay. So positive angle means anti-clockwise. Negative angle to be chosen for clockwise. Okay. So let us recall the formula. Your small x is capital X cos theta plus capital Y. Let us look at the formula here. Whatever we have got. Capital X cos theta minus capital Y sin theta. Minus capital Y sin theta. So let me go back. Yeah, so minus capital Y sine theta and small y will be capital X sine theta plus capital Y cos theta. Okay, so very good, Ritu. Let's check. Okay, so your X will get replaced with capital X cos 45, which is 1 by root 2, minus sine 45, which is minus y by root 2. Your small y will get replaced with capital X by root 2 plus capital Y by root 2. Okay, so just place it over here. So 3 capital X by root 2 minus capital Y by root 2 whole square plus 2 capital X by root 2 minus capital Y by root 2 times capital X by root 2 plus capital Y by root 2 plus 3 capital X by root 2 plus capital Y by root 2 whole square is equal to 10. Lot of things we can do with these root 2. First of all, they both have root 2, so you can bring it out. So it will be 3 by 2 x minus y the whole square. And root 2 will get cancelled. So this will give you x square minus y square. This will also give you 3/4 x plus y the whole square. Okay, equal to 10. Okay, if you mix these two, it will become, it will become 3/2 into 2 times x square, 2 times y square. Okay, this will be x square minus y square only, equal to 10. Let us simplify this further. So this is going to be, 3x square, 3y square, plus x square minus 2y square equal to 10, which is 4x square plus 2y square equal to 10. Or you can say 2x square, sorry, this is going to be, this is going to be 2x square plus y square equal to 5. Did anybody get this answer? 2x square plus y square equal to 5. Got it? Is the idea clear? Okay. So through this entire exercise, we learned that when we are shifting the origin, let me summarize it over here. I will not take up any question here. I'll just summarize it. Summary of shifting of origin. Summary of shifting of origin was, your small x is replaced with capital X plus H and small y is replaced with capital Y plus K. Okay. And what is the summary of rotation of axes? Rotation of axes. So remember, your small x is replaced with capital X cos theta minus capital Y sine theta. Correct? And small y is replaced with capital X sine theta plus capital Y cos theta. Don't forget, theta is to be taken as positive if rotation is anti-clockwise. And theta is to be taken as negative if your coordinate axes were rotated clockwise. That's it. This is the moral of the entire discussion that we had after the break. Got the point? Okay, with this you can solve the DPPs that we have. I'll be sending you today.